Penguin Random House Audio presents Old Time Radio's Greatest Shows, Volume 43, featuring George Burns, Gracie Allen, Lucille Ball, and many more. Edited by Carl Amari.
The Adventures of Frank Race, starring Tom Collins. War changed many things, the face of the earth and the people on it. Before the war, Frank Race worked as an attorney, but he traded his law books for the cloak and dagger of the OSS. And when it was over, his former life was over too. Adventure had become his business. The Adventures of Frank Race.
Say the way you wake up has an important effect on the whole of your day. Coming awake peacefully sets you off to a relaxed, poised beginning. So I came out of my nocturnal fog to the sound of...
Now listen, you're gonna talk to him if I have to beat your brains? Oh, now look what you did. Just because you want to be stubborn.
Mark, for Pete's sake.
Oh, are you awake?
Am I awake? What are you trying to do, break my lease?
Well, we just want to talk to you.
You both wanted to talk to me? And somehow I have the idea that the desire isn't exactly mutual.
But this guy's in trouble, Frank, and he's a friend of mine. His name is Bob Kennedy, and he drives a hack, just like me.
It was cold outside, and all Kennedy had on for a coat was a worn army field jacket. He needed a shave, and the way he shaped up, he could have... done with some solid meals. His features were distorted with fear.
I've been telling him, Frank, if anybody can help him, you can. Go on, Bob, spill a story.
Oh, look, Mark, we're wasting time. I gotta get out of town. It's my only chance.
Your only chance for what?
He thinks his wife is in the morgue, Grace.
Any connection with that item in yesterday's paper? An unidentified girl?
Yeah, that's it. Same description, her clothes...
The report said there was plenty of indication that she might have been murdered. How do you fit in, Bob?
Well, would you believe me if I say I didn't do it?
Now let me get dressed. I think we'd better go to the morgue and have a look at that girl. And on the way, you can break this down for me. Ex-GI, studying architecture on a BA program. His wife had been an English war bride. He told me about it as we drove.
I didn't marry into the royal family or anything like that. She worked in the factory during the war making ammunition. But she was pretty. No guy could have a better wife.
Yet you had a fight.
Yeah. We picked a great place to pull it off. In a cafeteria with a million people around. She left me there. That's all I know.
Where might she have gone, Bob?
Oh, I don't know. Unless it was to look for a job.
This is it. And I know the boys in here, so you might let me do the talking. The girl in the morgue was Bob Kennedy's wife, all right. She still looked pretty and young, even lying there. Bob's stricken eyes came up to meet mine, staring at me. I shrugged at the attendant, and he replaced the sheet. I think you ought to go to the police, Bob.
Oh, after that fight? You know what else? We had insurance policies on each other. Double indemnity endowments. Yeah, they were her idea. For our old age and to protect the kid. There's the big fat motive they're going to pin on me.
You have a child.
2 years old. Boy.
That money could be important to him.
Sure. Sure it could.
He'll never use a quarter of it if the court declares you guilty of murdering his mother. And hiding out now is going to look bad. If you turn yourself in...
Not a chance. I haven't got a prayer, and I know it. I'm going to say thanks and get lost.
Mark's cab stood at the curb. Mark shot me a warning look as I came out. There was reason for his attitude. On the sidewalk waited a couple of gentlemen who might have been ward healers just for getting out the vote. The smaller of the pair intercepted me at the bottom of the steps.
You're Frank Race, ain't you?
That's right. And you?
What's the idea of casing the morgue?
Maybe I live here.
You don't, but you might. What's the story?
Sorry. Saving that for my biography.
Yeah? Well, we'll see how long you save it. Okay, get in the cab.
He had his argument in his hand, a snub-nosed automatic. So I shrugged and moved toward the taxi. At the same time, Mark slid across the seat and stepped out as though to open the door for us, and immediately pinwheeled into action with a 14-inch end wrench.
Take the big guy, Frank!
Watch it, Mark!
Hey, miss me.
Get on the city!
It is washed up as of now.
And you too, Marlowe!
Oh, brother, that wraps him up. Yeah. Come on, Frank, let's get out of here before that shot brings the boys in blue.
Now, as soon as I unload this gun. What's the story on that Milo personality? You seem to know him.
Milo Morgan? Sightney. He belongs to Larry Carmichael, a ragged boss. Why?
Larry Carmichael. Good lad, Marcus. You've steered me into the lead I've been looking for. I knew Larry Carmichael. Big fellow with blonde curly hair that was going gray. Found him in his nightclub office practicing billiard shots.
Hey, what's the pitch on you anyway? You come in here for the first time in a year and all you do is ask questions.
Too nosy?
I don't like questions. You ought to know that.
Ever hear of a girl called Faye Kennedy?
I know lots of people.
I saw her a little while ago. On a slab in the morgue.
Go on out to the bar. Have yourself a drink. I sell good liquor.
But you don't want to talk about the Kennedy girl.
I gave a party. I had lots of guests. Your dame was there. I never knew it. And if you keep playing cop, I'm going to get sore.
I left him as he muffed his third shot, which wasn't like him. It was still early in the evening, but several people were sitting at the bar. As I went by, a voice tagged me.
Heave to, Frank. It's martini time.
Well, Larry Carmichael Jr. You've grown up.
Sit down, Race. This is Bunny Covington.
Hello, Race.
Dusky hair and blue eyes are always tough on a man. When they go with everything else this girl had to offer, you wanted to sit down. Slowly. Bunny Covington, number one glamour deb of the season. Top of the bottle for looks, poise, or money.
Quit staring, Ray. She's going to stay a while. What have you been doing?
I just finished chatting with your father.
How'd you find him?
His billiard game is off. His disposition's off with it.
If he's playing billiards, he's feeling happier than he did yesterday. Might be a good time for me to interview him. Stay put, children. I'll be back.
So the kid has made the big league.
Meaning me?
According to the rotos, you're an ultra-exclusive package.
People talk about you, too.
Yeah, I'm not as pretty, though.
Well, you make an impression. I understand you enjoy getting into trouble.
Kids like Larry are inclined to exaggerate.
Is that what you're doing now? Getting into trouble?
If you're talking about this very moment, I'd say the answer was yes.
I'm going to enjoy you, Race. How would you like to take me somewhere else? I'm in the mood to patronize several spots tonight.
What about young Larry?
Oh, he's a charming boy. But I'm not wearing fraternity pins this season.
Well, I must make a phone call first.
Well, go ahead and make it. And to ease your conscience, I'll say goodbye to Larry Jr.
My call was to the Homicide Bureau, to a friend by the name of Lieutenant Vander. I asked him if the girl in the morgue had been identified.
Sure, a kid called Faye Kennedy.
Well, how's it going, the book? Homicide?
She was found alongside the highway, dead.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.